generated by transport, by DC transport in such as structures. So we're very welcome, Ora, with presentations, please.
Thank you very much for the nice introduction. And on the screen, you can see my subject, which is DC current and magnetization generated by microwave-induced spin-orbit interaction. And the picture shows you my university, and below are the funds that I have to acknowledge. So let me start by putting the picture of our deceased friend and collaborator, Ilya Krive. And the few words below are not written in Hebrew. They are rather written in Aramaic, which is the language of the Kingdom of Babylon. And I read it in Aramaic, and you can see the meaning just below, which it says, "Chaval al de'avdin velo mishtakhin." And I think Robert would like, Robert and Sergei would like to say a few words while we have the picture of Ilya. So please,
well, let me just, thanks. Let me just say a few words without distracting too much. So it was a real shocking loss. We learned recently that Ilya left this world. He was a central member of the ASG activities at our center, together with Robert and a number of other, and Ora, of course, and a number of other distinguished scientists. And we will miss him a lot. And he was an excellent researcher, he was a teacher, and he was an excellent friend. And we hope that we will keep up and continue his legacy. And I think I should not take more than that time from you. And I'm not sure whether Robert wants to say something right now. Robert has a very deep relationship with Ilya. And Robert, if you don't...
I would like just to add a few words that we will miss very much Ilya in our future work. It was very noticeable that he was always next to me and giving a wise advice, and his knowledge was encyclopedic knowledge in solid states, and not only solid states. We use it heavily, asking his advices and comment on events which happened in science in our life. He was excellent. He was a very wise person and very kind. And I think all members of our group will miss him, and we will continue definitely the work and the legacy him. So that's all what I want to add.
Okay, so I think that this word from the Talmud, very old book of 2000 years, we describe as a personality.
Very nice words.
Okay, so let us go to business. And here is the plan of my talk, and I hope that I will succeed to cover it. So I'll start with some advertisement to tell you why should we study spin-orbit interactions. I'll say a few words about the spin-orbit Hamiltonian and, you know, spin-orbit interactions and semiconductors. I'll come to our business, which is tunnel junctions, and we need to know how to include in a tunnel junction the spin-orbit interaction. And they will hint some words about the connection between the tunneling amplitude and the Aronoff-Kasher phase factor. And then we'll go to the main part, which is generating time-dependent Aronoff-Kasher phase by AC electric field and the generation of DC currents and DC magnetization. So let me start by the advertisement. The discovery of the giant magnetoresistance, which awarded the Nobel Prize in 2007, marked the birth of the field of science, which is called spintronics, meaning electronics exploiting the spin degree of freedom of electrons. So the second point is why GMR, that is giant magnetoresistance, has to do with metallic spintronics in conjunction with magnetism. Recent interest is focused on semiconductor spintronic devices along the track called spintronics without magnetism, using the spin-orbit interactions. And the nice thing is the spin-orbit interactions allow generation
No sound.
Excuse me? Okay. So let me say a few words about, hello?
Professor Entin-Wohlman, sorry, we lost you for a few seconds. Maybe the last sentence, if you can repeat.
I say that spin orbit and manipulation of I'm going to give a few examples. Is it okay now?
Okay, now we can hear you.
Ora, when you ask whether it's okay, it's okay. But
okay. So okay. On the left side of the screen, you see a theoretical device proposed a long time ago by Data and Das, which has to do with a transistor that works on spin-orbit interaction. In the yellow part, we have spin-orbit interaction, and the electrons that go from the left to the right change their spin direction as they move. Now, if they go between two ferromagnetic electrodes, then it depends how they arrive at the other side, whether they are parallel to the ferromagnetic moment in the electron or not. And therefore, if they are not parallel, then the device is off. And if they are parallel, they are on. And this is called the spintronic transistor. And it was tried in the laboratory many times. I'm not sure to the extent of the
I think we lost you again, Ora.
I think we have no connection with her now.
Now she's back again.
In my side, I see connection. Anyhow, what I want to tell you about the right side is that the y-axis is a measure for the spin orbit strength. It is measured in the kind of length, I'll come to that. But you see that as function of the gate voltage, which is the x-axis, we can change considerably, significantly, the strength of the spin orbit coupling. Next, we discuss how do we detect spin currents or spin accumulation. The well-known effect is the spin Hall effect. And what is the spin Hall effect? So let's look at the Hall effect. The Hall effect is a piece of metal in which we send current. And a magnetic field is applied perpendicular to it. And as a result, the electronic current is shifted and the voltage is created perpendicular to the current flow direction. The spin-Hall effect is the same, except that we don't have the magnetic field, but we have the spin-orbit interaction. And as a result, when we apply current, we get spin accumulation perpendicular to the current. And this spin accumulation is usually measured by the k rotation of light due to the different spin directions. And I give here the number, if there are experimentalists, of how strong is this spin accumulation. Okay, so let me say a few words about the spin orbit interaction in the quantum. A speed of light, one finds a bunch of terms. The first one is the kinetic energy and the potential, or the potential energy, just the Schrödinger equation. The second one is a kind of correction to the kinetic energy, if it is of no interest to us today. And the last one is related to the second, to the Laplacian of the potential. It's called the Darwin theorem, and this theorem will not be also of interest today. But this theorem, the third one, is the spin orbit coupling. And what we see the spin, which is S, the gradient of the potential, which will be very important for us, and the momentum. And the spin orbit coupling, if the potential is rotationally symmetric, then this gradient cross P, cross the momentum, is just the angular momentum. So this term is simply spin dot L divided by the speed of light squared, which is not a big number, as we know. But in solids, the situation is a bit different. Why is this? Let me first express the spin as I am going to express it throughout the talk, namely in terms of the Pauli matrices, which will be sigma. The gradient of the potential is minus an electric field. So we have an electric field cross the momentum. That is the spin orbit interaction, another expression for it. And if you play around, you see that this spin orbit Hamiltonian is sigma dot something, that something is E cross P, electric field cross the momentum. And this is kind of, it looks like the Zeeman interaction if we identify the E cross P with a magnetic field, effective magnetic field due to the spin orbit interaction. And here I show you the directions. So you have the momentum, you have the electric field, and the effective magnetic field will be perpendicular to both. However, one should keep in mind all the time that if we have a true Zeeman interaction by a true magnetic field, then a time reversal symmetry is broken in the system. However, spin orbit interaction does not break time reversal symmetry. This is the most important message that you have to remember of all this. So what is the origin of the electric field in semiconductors? First, we have intrinsic electric fields due to lack of inversion symmetry. I'll give you a few examples. And second, we have extrinsic electric field that can be controlled in the lab. And then this is the way one modulates the spin orbit interaction. And this second origin of electric field is in particular important
or have we lost you?
Can you hear me now?
Yes, when you ask, yeah. I hear you.
At least you can see what I...
Yes, we see
I'm sorry about...
We see the slides, that's okay.
Yeah, I'm sorry about that. So I was saying that the effect of extrinsic electric field is in particular important in low dimensional semiconductor or low dimensional system, in fact, because then the internal electric fields do not cancel out as they usually do in a bulk system. So first I'll say a few words about the intrinsic origin of the electric field in semiconductors, and then we leave this subject. So I say the energy bands of a bulk that obey time reversal symmetry and inversion symmetry, the energy band are not sensitive to the spin. Namely, the energy we spin up is equal to the energy of spin down. However, if we have time reversal symmetry and broken inversion symmetry, then the energy band for spin up is not equal to the energy band of spin down. And this is like an electric field. So there is a spin dependence. And materials that show this this behavior are usually in the zinc blended class, for example, gallium arsenic. Here is on the left, you can see the picture of the unit cell. And then one sees that because the spin orbit interaction starts to be active, you have a small degeneracy lifting by the spin orbit interaction. So this is an internal effect of the spin orbit interaction. An external effect or extrinsic electric field, electric field is go under the name of the Rashba spin orbit coupling. And they are specific in nowadays for low dimensional system. And let's
we lost
this led to so I'm talking about the Rashba spin orbit coupling, which is specific for a low dimensional systems where the spin orbit interaction is operating only in the plane, and therefore it takes the form of this kind of combination, the y direction, let's say that the slab is in the xy plane. So there is the y direction of the momentum times the x direction of the spin according to the Pauli matrix minus the other way around. And if you look at it, then you see that again, we have this situation where we have momentum, spin, and direction of electric field, which is normal to the slab in a kind of this product. Here I'm using my notation, case O is going to be the strength of the spin orbit interaction in units of 1/length. Sigma is again the spin operator, and M star being the effective mass. And if we add such an Hamiltonian, such spin orbit Hamiltonian to the kinetic energy of the electrons, then as we well know, which is again like a magnetic field, we can complete the square as they say, and then this term like the sigma cross Z looks like a vector potential. So keep it in mind because there is this analogy with the magnetic field because it will come important in a few minutes. Okay, so can we detect the Rashba spin orbit interaction in heterostructures, which are our business? And this was done a very long time ago by a group in entity in Japan. And these people had this heterostructure, and they measured what is called the Asman-Alfred oscillation of the magneto resistance. The Asman-Alfred oscillations occur because you apply a magnetic field. And if you have also spin orbit interaction, then they change the oscillation, as you can see here. And from this result, one can deduce the strength of the spin orbit interaction. And what they did was to apply on top of everything that I said so far, they applied also a gate voltage or an electric field. Maybe you remember my first slide with the Datadas spin transistor, which in which the idea is that the caricature of the idea, which I tried to do here, and this goes as following. We have a tunnel junction. I'll explain what is a tunnel junction in a few minutes. And we have a source of electrons and we have a drain. And we send electrons, let's say we spin down and it will go to the tunnel barrier where there is spin orbit interaction and it will not pass through, it will go backwards. And then an electron with the other spin direction will go through. So we'll have a transistor. So that was the vision. Let us find a system that filters spins by the spin orbit interaction. It allows, that of course an idealistic vision, it allows only one direction of the spin to pass. So let us see if this will work. So first let me discuss what are tunnel junction. On the left you see tunnel junction for trains. This is also tunnel junction for little children. And now we come to a picture. This is experimentalist vision of a tunnel junction. This tunnel junction has a source, or this one is the source, and a drain. These are the blue blocks. And then you have two tunnel junctions in this picture, this one and this one. In the middle, you have something that usually is called quantum dot. And the idea is to calculate what is the current of through this junction. If you want to see a more mature picture of this thing, then you have a source and a drain, and you have a quantum dot in between. Here are the two tunnel junctions. And here you applied a gate voltage such that you change the inside of these things. You can manipulate the spin orbit interaction. And now, how does it look in reality? And in
no voice.
Okay, I hear you. So this is a tunnel junction. This is the source, you see S. This is the drain, so the electron goes this way. And you can apply what they call plunge gate. It is the gate voltage. And this be because this was in a magnetic field, so I couldn't take out this from the figure. So that's experiment. But I am not experimentalist, I am theorist. And here is how a tunnel junction looks in my imagination. So we have a source and a drain, or if you wish, we have two terminals. And two terminals for us are two electron gas. And electron gas is characterized, these are big reservoirs. So they are characterized by their temperature and their chemical potential. There are of course at equilibrium. And the chemical potential in the temperatures of the two reservoirs need to be the same. And therefore there will be current. In this case, if you have also temperature difference, there will be also an energy current, but we will not talk about this. And in between the electron has to pass through something which is called junction or link. And here we want to apply our spin orbit interaction. So the reservoirs in my picture are going to be characterized by the Fermi distribution, the simple Fermi distribution, which I write here, namely one over the exponential of the energy minus the chemical potential added by the temperature plus one, the usual Fermi distribution. And what you can change with the gate potential is the chemical potential. You can change also the number of electrons, etc. I'll come to this. Okay, so what we have to do is to write a tunneling Hamiltonian. Now, how does a tunneling Hamiltonian look like, or the total Hamiltonian of the system? You have the Hamiltonian of the left reservoir, here it is. So if we view the left reservoir as a free electron gas, then we'll have just the kinetic energy, which is here written in terms of creation and annihilation operator, second quantization. The same story for the light reservoir, where the momentum, I don't distinguish between wave vector and momentum because I take h bar to be one. As I told you, I am a theorist. And I write it as speed just to distinguish it from the right side. And the difference between the two reservoirs is by their temperature and chemical potential. And then you have the junction Hamiltonian, which is our main player. And the junction Hamiltonian is the tunneling Hamiltonian that take you from, let's say here, take you kills an electron on the right and put it on the left. Now, usually in tunneling Hamiltonian, the spin index is not changed, the same spin projection. But if our tunneling Hamiltonian, tunneling amplitude, which is this quantity, if it is a spin orbit active, then you can have a tunneling with a spin change or without spin change. You have both situations. So this is the tunneling Hamiltonian. So the first task is, let's calculate this tunneling amplitude that can change the spin direction and comes from spin orbit interaction. And this, luckily enough, was done for us by Shabazian and Reich again a long time ago. And it is a very nice argument. And this, it goes like this. What we have to calculate to know what is the tunneling amplitude is what is the propagator that goes from one situation to the other situation. And this is let's say it's a straight line. So we have to take the Green's function, which is one over the energy, and the energy always the Fermi energy, so I write F, the energy minus the Hamiltonian of the junction to the minus one, and you have to calculate this Fourier transform of it, if you wish. Now, the Hamiltonian of the junction can include many, many things. It can include a magnetic field, if we wish. We wish that magnetic field will not be part of this talk, but it can, in principle, have it. And the magnetic field has two effects on the motion of electrons. We have the vector potential that affects the orbital motion, and we have the Zeeman term, the true Zeeman term. And then, we also have the spin orbit interaction. Here it is written like this because the spin orbit interaction, as I said before, it was the momentum. But if you have a vector potential, then you have to generalize the momentum to the canonical momentum. But if you forget about the external magnetic field, then you have a very simple Hamiltonian of the junction. And you can carry out this calculation. It's not so difficult. And at the end of the day, you get, apart from the prefactor, which is the usual tunneling amplitude, you get an exponential factor of this type, where S stands for the pass that the electron took, sigma is the spin operator, and N is the direction of the electric field that creates the spin orbit interaction. And this is this four. And this four, lo and behold, first it conserved time versus symmetry. I'm not going to show it, but it's very easy. And second, if you look at it, it is a unitary operator. And the two facts are interconnected, and they will be very important. So here it is again. The tunneling amplitude is modified by this term. And therefore, if the junction width, let's say, is D, or the weak link is a of length D, then after we do the integral, which is not so complex, and the motion is along X, we get this term. And as a result, here it is again, the tunneling Hamiltonian becomes this theta, and the tunneling amplitude is what I said before, this unitary matrix. And using a well-known relation for operators of this type, you know that it is cosine of the spin orbit strength times the distance, plus sine of the same thing, and then comes this E dot sigma, E being the this direction, the direction of motion times the direction of the electric field. And this is a very nice result because, as you can see, if we are going to measure anything that depends on the spin orbit interaction, it will be oscillatory with the spin orbits. And this is very important. So what do we see? Because of this term, we see that the tunneling amplitude can, the electrons that tunnel via this tunneling amplitude can flip their spin and also cannot, can stay with the same spin direction. But in any event, because this is a unitary matrix, then you can see immediately the TT dagger is only the prefactor. All the things that depend on the spin orbit interaction disappears. And as a result, because if you remember, let's say the golden rule, it's only TT dagger that gives you the conductance, then you know immediately that if you have a tunnel junction with spin orbit interaction, then there will be no effect whatsoever on the conductance of the tunnel junction. So let me say it again, because it's a very important result. The tunneling amplitude with spin orbit interaction is a unitary matrix because spin orbit conserves time reversal symmetry. As a result, TT dagger does not depend on the spin orbit and the conductance is not affected by the spin orbit interaction. So the origin of our troubles is the time reversal symmetry. If we break time reversal symmetry, then we can use spin orbit interaction to affect the spin. And let me skip this because of the time. So we need to break time reversal symmetry. This is very simple. The first thing that you think that comes to mind is let's put a magnetic field. But then as I advertise our work is to do spintronics without magnetism. So what have we done? But we can apply a current. This indeed leads to the spin Hall effect in break time reversal symmetry. We can use a junction with, not with two terminal or two reservoir, but with three, and measure the current between two of them. This also has the effect of kind of breaking time reversal symmetry. But what we did in our group is use time dependent spin orbit coupling. Of course, time dependent breaks time reversal symmetry, so we are in business. And now I come to the following. As I said, the spin orbit active tunneling amplitude is a T0 times some matrix, phase factor. And this phase factor is a matrix. This is the Aronoff-Kasher phase factor. What we want to do, or what we want to have, is to have it time dependent. And how can this be done? Remember that all this product comes from the direction of the motion, that's X in my case, then the direction of the electric field, and then the spin.
No sound, Ora. No connection.
In my side, this is connected, so I don't know what.
Yes, this is why I let you know that we lost.
Okay, so I'm going to say that if we take our junction or our weak link, here is our weak link, this is the axis, and if we apply two gate voltages along Y and along Z, X is the direction of the motion, then we can have a direction of the electric field, which is a circular polarized, namely in the plane, in the YZ plane, the plane perpendicular to the direction of motion, and the AC field has the frequency capital omega. So if we apply this end here, we find that the tunneling amplitude becomes time dependent. I have to refer to a very recent work that we did in the PCS with some of our friends here. Okay, so now we we have to solve the following problem. We again have our tunnel junction with two reservoirs with two temperatures and two chemical potential. The same story of the Hamiltonian for the two reservoirs, and the tunneling Hamiltonian is now time dependent. And it is time dependent because we create the spin orbit interaction by an AC field, a microwave field diffusion. Now, what do we calculate out of all these? So we can calculate, or I give as an example, we can calculate two things. We can calculate the current. And if you take just usual quantum mechanics, I write the current in of the electric charge. And the current is just the time derivative of the number of particles, let's say in the left side, which is of course time dependent. And by these brackets, I mean quantum average. We can calculate some other quantity. The other quantity we can calculate is what is the time dependence of the magnetization in the reservoir, again, the left reservoir. The magnetization is in unit of H bar over. And the magnetization looks like the quantum average that comes into the current, except that destroys an electron with a spin direction sigma prime. There is the Pauli matrix in general, it's the vector of the Pauli matrix, and create it at another direction sigma. So this is what we calculated, in fact, the quantum average of this quantity or this quantity, given this Hamiltonian. So that's what we did. Okay, so how do we calculate the, here I repeat it again, so you will remember what a quantum average is I wanted to do. And you see that here I need the quantum average of the two operator with the same spin direction, while here I need it with different spin direction in general. So we calculated in general the quantum average of C sigma prime. And that's where it's not difficult. And at the end of the day, you find that this average has the following form. It depends on the difference between the two Fermi function of the two reservoirs, which means that if you keep the reservoirs at the same chemical.
No sound, Ora, I lost you.
Is it okay?
Yeah.
Okay, no? Okay. So I was saying that the result shows that we must, in order to have this difference being different than zero to get something, we must have a difference in the two chemical, in the two Fermi function of the left and the right. And this is multiplied by a correlation in time of the tunneling amplitude. And this correlation in time can be calculated. It's not so difficult. I'll show you the result in a minute. But you can see, again, what I said before, that if the tunneling amplitude are not time dependent, then the current will flow only in a bias junction, only if you apply bias, and it will not depend on the spin orbit interaction. The spin current will vanish in this case, simply because in order to find the spin current, or if you wish the time derivative of the magnetization, you need to have sigma different than sigma prime. What else I wanted to say? And there will be no dependence on the spin orbit coupling. And the reason for this is the time reversal symmetry. However, if the so that's the pose. So if we have a spin orbit interaction which is not time dependent, then we cannot get this nice idealistic picture. There will be no filtering by the junction. However, if we have our time dependent AC field, then we can calculate this correlation function of the tunneling amplitude, and we find that the dependence is on the time difference of the two times here, that in the correlation, t equals t minus t prime. And therefore, we do get effect of the spin orbit interaction on the conductance, on the current, and we do get spin curve. The spin curve, of course, vanishes when the spin orbit interaction is not there, as you can see. The conductance, of course, does not vanish, but the effect of the spin orbit interaction vanishes. And what you see else is that whatever we get is a oscillatory in the spin orbit strength. And this is the result of this paper that was done in our group. So what we have found so far is that we have, if we have time dependent spin orbit coupling, then the tunneling depends on time. The conductance is modified by the spin orbit coupling. And there appear DC spin current. Maybe to show this one, I need to go back. And I'll tell you the following. What we find for our quantum average is this quantity. And the important point here is that it depends on the time difference. Mm-hmm. And if we go back to what we have, let's go back now. Okay. If you go back to this expression, then if you see that if this depends only on the time differences, then you get here, which is independent, namely a DC result. And therefore, we find DC spin current, even for a bias which is not, even for a junction which is unbiased. Namely, the temperatures are the same, the chemical potential are the same, and nonetheless, the flies a spin current. And the spin current is proportional to, in a manner, proportional to the spin orbit interaction. It of course vanishes when there is no, when the frequency of the AC field vanishes, we must have a AC electric field. And as a result, the idea that we'll get some filtering works, namely, we'll have a spin current. I have to say here that I'm talking here about the all everything flows along the x direction, which is my picture. And you may ask which direction of the magnetization current I'm talking about. And I am talking about the direction, the x direction of the magnetization. The other two directions, because they still flow along the x direction, but they depend on time. They are not DC. That was the result of that paper. I think, okay. Now I come to the, let's create DC magnetization. That will be my last topic. So let us see the following. Suppose now that I don't have a junction. All that I have is a quantum dot. Here it is. Connected to one reservoir called lift. And I am going to, again, to do the same thing, namely to take a spin orbit created by a AC electric field. And then the magnetic field, the effective magnetic field, due to the spin orbit interaction, will have this form, the direction, which is the time dependent, times the direction of the motion, which is x. And if you look at this effective magnetic field, and here I make a little twist to the story, I take the rotating the AC field to have this little gamma that changed the amount of the y direction as compared to the z direction of the electric field, such that if gamma equals one, then we have perfectly circular electric field. And if gamma equals zero, we have linear polarization. And you will see in a minute why it is so nice. So if we have this type of effective magnetic field due to the spin orbit interaction, we can write it, we can play around and write it in this way as coefficients of the exponential of the frequency of the electric field. And the end result looks awful, as you see. So let's see if we can make any sense of vision, a very nice contribution Robert made to our thing. And what Robert discovered very nicely is that we can take this awful expression that I have shown here and write it very carefully with all the Pauli matrices that comes in and with this gamma that distinguishes between the fully circular polarization of the electric field and linear polarization and playing around. And then at the end of the day, you see that you have the one component of the field times sigma plus and the other plus this one. Now, sigma plus or sigma minus is sigma y plus minus I sigma z, namely these are the increasing or decreasing spin along x. So you see that if gamma equals zero and we have a linearly polarized electric field, we have sigma plus plus sigma minus, and sigma plus sigma minus tells us that the same amount of increasing the projection of the spin, increasing it, namely nothing happens to the spin. So you can see immediately that for a linearly polarized electric field, there will be no effect. And if the electric field is fully circular polarized, which happens when gamma equals one, then you have only one of the two. You can have gamma equals one or gamma equals minus one. It depends on the direction of the circular rotation. But you have only one of these. So either you increase the spin or you decrease the spin, but you don't have their cancellation. And if gamma is not zero and not one, then you have something in between. So the end result is that by this electric field, we can create a magnetization that is DC, is not dependent on time. This you can see by looking at the expression at very low temperature, then you have only one of the one of the two terms contribute. And therefore you have either in the increase along the one, the positive direction of X or the negative direction. So in this way, one can get magnetization, which is a DC magnetization. What do we magnetize? We magnetize the dot. So you can calculate the magnetization on the dot. This is done by doing the full Keldysh technique. You calculate the lesser Green's function of the Keldysh technique and you have to do a little work. It's not so difficult. And the quantum dot is characterized by its energy and the energy gets some width. That's the bright width because it's connected to a large reservoir. But at the end of the day, and because of time, I will not go into the details. At the end of the day, you get magnetization on the dot, which is DC. It is in the limit of small spin orbit interaction, the oscillatory behavior disappeared, but you see it is related to the spin orbit interaction, and it is related to the frequency of the AC electric field. And this is calculated for the fully circularly electric field. And if you want to see how this function looks like, so here it is for several values of the bright Wigner resonance width on the dot. I think that I will not go into the magnetization in the lead, but I'll tell you that we calculated them. And you can see in the magnetization current the oscillatory behavior with respect to the spin orbit strength that I told you about. So let me go over the plan again to tell you what I have done. The advertisement we skip. So we said that there are two origins for the spin orbit Hamiltonian in semiconductors. Comes free, can be induced by external electric field. We can make that external electric field oscillatory in time. And then we have a spin orbit tunnel junction, which breaks time reversal symmetry. That was very important. If you don't break time reversal symmetry, a two-terminal junction will not know that we have the spin orbit interaction. And then we can show that by an AC electric field, we can generate DC spin current. And if we have a quantum dot, we can generate DC magnetization on the quantum dot. And if you want more details, then you have to look at our paper. These are the it is the reference. And this is part of the team in a very nice sushi restaurant in the Gion, which I hope to see again sometime in my life. And thank you for your attention. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Entin-Wohlman. So let's thank. Okay, so we have time for questions now. So please, if anyone has a question, please raise your hand.
Hi, Dibashri.
Hi. Hi, Ora.
Nice to see you.
Yeah, same here.
Dibashri is in here.
Yeah, so it's a nice talk, Ora. I would like to ask you that whether this direction of the spin current would depend on this parameter omega. I mean, what would be the direction of this spin current?
The direction of the spin current, I say it again, that it moves along x, which is the direction of the junction. But of course, there are three directions to the magnetization because spin is a vector.
Yes.
What we find in our formulation is that the spin current of the magnetization along x, that moves along x, is a DC. The other two directions are AC, they depend on time. Now, of course, everything will vanish with the frequency of the AC field, because if the AC field becomes constant in time, namely with zero frequency, then you don't break time reversal symmetry and you are back to square zero. Nothing will depend on the spin orbit interaction. I have to say a little word of caution. A spin orbit interaction, all but everything, is a small interaction. So when we calculate it, when we calculate the tunneling amplitude in the presence of spin orbit interaction, is a kind of calculation up to the first order. And there will be some little tiny effects to second order, which will modify a little bit, say, the conductance. But these are really not significant.
Okay. Okay, thank you. I have another question that is what would be the value of omega? So whether the results would be same for some adiabatic limit or for fast moving omega.
That's another world of caution. We have an oscillatory field with a single frequency, so it can be large, it can be small. We have in mind microwave frequency. So that's the frequency. So I cannot say anything about the speed. It's a fixed frequency. For practical reason, we talk about microwave frequency, but the calculation doesn't know whether it is microwave or not.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Do we have any further questions?
Robin.
Yeah. First of all, thank you very much for excellent presentation, very clear and nice. The device, what you presented, I mean, this weak link, it's also can be employed as a mechanical device if you let this weak link or nanowire vibrate or do mechanical motion. This is how nanomechanical resonators are built in a system. So you talk about spin properties of these weak links. Are they coupled to, can be coupled to mechanical activity of the device? Can you comment on this?
I think the following. Since the spins are coupled to an electric field, the mechanical device should produce a kind of electric field, which couples to the spin. The way I see vibrating junctions, for example, is by putting some electron-phonon interaction. So if you ask about the interplay between electron-phonon interaction or electron-vibration interaction and the spin-orbit interaction, I think that I cannot say much because I'm not sure about it. But I think that there are many, or at least several works that I have seen that relates the spins to some mechanical vibration, or rather magnon-spin orbit interactions and things like this. But I don't think that I know much.
But spin orbit interaction itself will be sensitive probably to bending of the wire because it changed direction of the electronic flow.
That is correct, yeah. But the question is whether by changing the direction, so if you change the direction of the wire as a function of time, then you break time reversal symmetry and we are happy. If you relate the direction of the wire to some constant bend, then you don't break time reversal symmetry and we are back to square zero. So you need to break time reverse symmetry. Unfortunately,
say the mechanical vibration of the wire would.
Yeah, but that's mixing together a semi-classical with quantum mechanics. One has to be a bit careful about this.
Thank you.
If I may, Robert, let me remind you of the first paper you and Ora and I wrote.
Absolutely.
Which there was a quantum dot in the middle of the wire, and then the quantum dot can oscillate by vibrations, and that, of course, will generate a spin current through the wire. But you need a quantum dot.
Then you have a kind of a potential that you can see it like a time-dependent electric field in a way.
Yeah, in a sense, yes.
Yeah.
Ivan has a question. Ivan, please unmute yourself.
Okay. Hello. Thank you very much for your interesting talk. I have a question about the Keldysh technique which you use. I didn't get what is so non-equilibrium here that you need it, and is it possible to describe the system without the Keldysh using some Boltzmann equation?
For me, you ask a very difficult question, because for me, for me to do the Keldysh technique is easier than to, you see, if I want to use the Boltzmann equation for spins, then it's a big problem. How first I have to derive all the collision integral and so on. So I don't know if you can do it. My answer is I don't know. But I know that with the Keldysh technique it works. And why it's non-equilibrium? Because one calculates something which is time-dependent, which is considered non-equilibrium. And the Keldysh technique is very suitable. The Keldysh technique for this little junction with a single dot is extremely simple. So I never thought of doing it in the Boltzmann approach. But of course, there are, just yesterday we had in Tel Aviv a seminar about a kinetic equation approach, which I think it did at the end of the day, it did similar things to us, but it was so complicated, at least for me. Maybe I'm wrong. I don't know.
Just that the Boltzmann is usually simpler, that's why. So I'm just trying to figure out what is so difficult here that you really need such a serious weapon. I'm also working with some formalism like that. That's why I'm just curious why other people subscribe under such difficulties.
If you are talking about many body system, two-dimensional system, then the Kalish technique is hell. But if you have only a junction with quantum dot, believe me, it's very, very simple, much nicer than the Boltzmann. You have the feeling that you are doing something exact. And at the end of the day, I don't know to answer your question whether it is better or not, or simpler, or I don't know. You see the complexities in the eyes of the beholder, no?
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
Ora, I have also maybe a short question. So if I understand correctly, you break time reversal by applying this circular polarized field, correct? Light.
Correct.
Right. Could you also take a linearly polarized light with a second harmonic and a phase shift in that and break time reversal? In general, you would, of course, but will that...
I think that if you have two linearly polarized with different frequency that you mean by phase, then for me, this little gamma that I put there takes this into account. I think if the phase difference is very, very small. I think it will work, but it will be smaller because the circularly polarized I think it's the best in this sense.
Why?
Because it gives you the biggest result. Any other situation, any other combinations that we took gave it's a smaller result in magnitude.
I can maybe comment on this. If you have linearly polarized light, you will have in this qualitative picture, what's all represented, you will have two processes, spin up and spin down transitions generated by this time-dependent field. And amplitudes of both processes are the same, identical. It means that whatever you can pump up in a system, with the same probability you can pump down. It doesn't depend on perturbation, how many photon process you take into account, because there is this in Hamiltonian spin up and spin down processes presented on equal strengths. So that means that there will be no net spin pumping in this system, because spin up transition and spin down transition in every order of perturbation theory will cancel each other.
Yeah, Robert, but I think Sergei asks about two linearly polarized, two. Let's see.
So yeah, let me repeat maybe what I was asking about. You take a linearly polarized light field, mm-hmm. but you add a second component to it, which is exactly at a double frequency.
Then
you keep some phase shift in that. So you have to be very accurate with it to keep that phase difference core, so to say, during your whatever experiment or numerics.
Yeah.
So that basically is again a function of time, which lacks time reversal symmetry. So, yeah. So that was the question.
I just want to this what you said. I was talking only about the spin current. Of course, there will be effect on conductance if you apply voltage from spin orbit interaction if you take higher harmonics. But spin pumping, I don't expect. Of course, I cannot prove it exactly, but it's my expectation.
Yeah.
But will be spin conductance. I mean.
I think that one can, in principle, take all frequencies, but then that will be a hell of a calculation, I'm afraid. Mm.
Yeah.
Okay, do we have any further questions?
I should thank Ora again for very nice presentation, qualitative and clear. Thank you. Thank you
very much. Yes, let's thank Professor Entin-Wohlman again. So with this, we conclude today's seminar. So people that are interested in discussing afterwards should stay here, and we meet after 5 minutes for discussion. So thank you all for joining.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Ora, before we switch off, I mean,